Eu nem sei como começo. Fica tão difícil para mim. E digo coisas sem nexo. Perguntas porque estou assim. Eu nem sei explicar, nem vou contar. Que o tempo parou ver-te acordar. Esse teu jeito inocente que me faz não te querer largar. Mas ela diz que não dá. Não dá, não dá, não dá. E ela diz que não dá.
Well, hello everyone. On behalf of the EAPM and its board, we are pleased with Professor Diogo Ayres de Campos, President-elect, and Professor Miroslav Virgos, Secretary General, to welcome you to this webinar on preterm labor. This is the second webinar of a series of conferences organized by the EAPM. You can find the complete list of these conferences and their respective dates on the website of our association. You will also find the program of our next Congress, which will take place in Lisbon from July 14 to July 17, and to which I invite you and encourage you to register. I am sure you will enjoy this conference, and without further ado, I shall give the floor to Bo Jacobsson, member of the Special Interest Group of EAPM, and organizer of today's session, who will introduce the different topics and the speakers. It's up to you, Bo.
So thank you very much, Ili. It's an honor to be here and be the first webinar on in the EAPM, European Association of Perinatal Medicine, group of working groups. So we are really looking forward to this webinar today. And first, some kind of issues that you need to be aware of, that this session is recorded and we will put it on the EAPM homepage afterwards. We will also try to make it as kind of interactive as possible. So we ask the participants to submit questions to the Q&A in the bottom part of the display here. So you can put questions and please address them to specific speakers. And we will, in the end, we have half an hour for discussions. At, we will discuss it. You can also put technical questions there if you have any problems, and the MCA team will try to respond to that. So I will share my screen. So the first we have three different talks. It will be on prediction of preterm delivery on by cervical length measurement screening by Professor Valentin, and then I will speak about general consideration of prevention of preterm delivery, and then we will have a discussion about big data in the understanding of preterm delivery and the neonatal period. How should we take care of the baby? How could we generate this data and how could we use them, and so on. And we will have a discussion. And in the end, we have Gloria González Tristante from Spain that have submitted an abstract and will present that during 7 minutes of time. But first of all, I want to introduce Professor Lil Valentin from University of Lund in Sweden. She has been involved in ultrasound diagnostics from the very beginning of ultrasound, and she is one of the world leading experts on vaginal ultrasound. She had been engaging very much in diagnostic of ovarian tumors and had have worked for a long time with vaginal ultrasound for the cervix of the uterus. She was awarded in 2019 Ian McDonald's Gold Medal at ESOG for a massive scientific contribution to the area. And she have led a huge effort on cervical length measurement for the prediction of preterm delivery. So the floor is yours, Lynn. You're most welcome.
Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction, Boo. Okay, let me see here. Full screen. Full screen. Here we are. So prediction of preterm delivery by cervical length measurements in the second trimester. It is well known that there is a strong association between cervical length as measured with ultrasound at mid-gestation and the risk of spontaneous preterm delivery. The shorter the cervix, the higher the risk. And this is true in multiple pregnancies and in singleton pregnancies. But today I will discuss cervical length measurements only in singleton pregnancies. So how long is a normal cervix at mid-gestation? Cervical length as measured with ultrasound at mid-gestation depends on a number of factors, for example, obstetric history, ethnicity, the mother's BMI and age. And ethnicity seems to be a particularly important factor. For example, in this study from Kypros Nikolaidis group, the cervix was significantly shorter in Afro-Caribbean women than in women of other ethnicity, irrespective of the mother's obstetric history, BMI, and age. And a much higher proportion of Afro-Caribbean women had cervical length 15 millimeters or less than women of other ethnicity in this study. Now, there is some evidence that spontaneous preterm delivery can be prevented in women with singleton pregnancies and short cervix as measured with ultrasound at mid-gestation, for example, by treating them with vaginal progesterone, and therefore universal cervical length screening has been suggested and strongly advocated. However, before we implement cervical length screening, we need to know how well mid-trimester sonographic cervical length can discriminate between women who do and do not deliver preterm. In other words, we need to know the sensitivity and specificity of different cervical length cutoffs. We also need to know something about the clinical consequences of screening, for example, in terms of the number of false positive test results per one true positive test result, the number needed to screen to detect one spontaneous preterm delivery, and the size of the high-risk group, that is the size of the group of women identified as high-risk because of a short cervix. To determine the association between cervical length and spontaneous preterm delivery, there must be no intervention between the test and the outcome. In other words, the sensitivity and specificity of cervical length for prediction of preterm delivery can only be assessed in a blinded study. The first blinded study to be published was a study by Yams and co-workers. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 1996. Their study is a multi-center study conducted at 10 centers in the United States. Their study includes 2,915 women with a singleton pregnancy. They underwent ultrasound measurement of cervical length at 22 to 24 weeks. 63% of the women were Black, and a very high proportion had low socioeconomic status. 72% had not completed high school, and 54% had a monthly income below $800. The outcome measure was spontaneous preterm delivery before 35 weeks, and a very high proportion of women in this study did deliver spontaneously before 35 weeks, 4.3%. The authors used an ROC curve to select cervical length cutoffs suitable for clinical use. And they suggested three cervical length cutoffs, 20 millimeter, 25 millimeter, and 30 millimeter. And as you can see here, the detection rate, the sensitivity of the 20 millimeter cutoff was quite low, 23%. That of the 25 millimeter cutoff was quite low, 37%. The detection rate of the 30 millimeter cutoff was higher, 54%, but the specificity of the 30 millimeter cutoff was very low. I have plotted these results in an ROC curve, and I estimate that the area under the ROC curve was somewhere between 0.65 to 0.70. Very moderate discriminative ability. I'm well aware that it is not fair to draw an ROC curve based on only three measurement points, and we don't know the shape of the ROC curve of these authors. Maybe the area under the curve was actually larger than this one. After the study by Yams and co-workers was published, there were four other published blinded studies. And I show the characteristics of these studies in this table. And the characteristics of the five studies are very different. The studies differ with regard to ethnicity, the prevalence of spontaneous preterm delivery, and the time in pregnancy when cervical length was measured. They also differ with regard to outcome measure. But in four of the studies, the outcome measure was spontaneous preterm delivery before 35 weeks. So what were the results? Well, all five studies reported sensitivity and specificity of at least one of the three cervical length cutoffs that Yams and colleagues had suggested, 20, 25, and 30 millimeters. Two research teams used ROC curve to try to identify other possible clinical cutoffs, and they came up with the 27 millimeter cutoff and the 29 millimeter cutoff. But only one research team reported the area under the ROC curve for spontaneous delivery before 34 weeks, and the area was 0.68. Quite moderate discriminative ability. This table shows you the discriminative ability of the 25 millimeter cervical length cutoff in these five blinded studies. And you can see that the sensitivity is very variable. It ranges from 7% to 58%, and the size of the high risk group, that is the proportion of women with cervical length 25 millimeter or less, is also extremely variable. It ranges from 7.3% to 11%. On the basis of these published results, we found it impossible to estimate the discriminative ability of cervical length in a population of mainly white women with low prevalence of spontaneous preterm delivery. So therefore, we decided to perform a study of our own. And I will now tell you the design and results of our study. Our study is a prospective blinded multicenter study conducted at seven hospitals in Sweden. We recruited consecutive asymptomatic women with a singleton pregnancy at their routine second trimester ultrasound scan. The study protocol included two measurements of cervical length, one at 18 to 20 weeks performed on the very day of the routine scan, and a second measurement at 21 to 23 weeks, at least 14 days later. Our study population consists of 11,072 women with a cervical length measurement at 18 to 20 weeks, our cervix 1 population, and of 6,288 women with a cervical length measurement at 21 to 23 weeks, our cervix 2 population. About 90% of the women were of white ethnicity. Less than 10% had low socioeconomic status. The rate of spontaneous delivery before 33 weeks was 0.5% in our cervix 1 population and 0.4% in our cervix 2 population. So what were the results? We found that the ability to correctly predict spontaneous preterm delivery was substantially better for measurements taken at 21 to 23 weeks than at 18 to 20 weeks. We found that the discriminative ability was better the earlier the spontaneous delivery occurred. It was good for spontaneous delivery before 28 weeks. It was moderate for spontaneous delivery before 33 weeks, and it was poor for spontaneous delivery before 37 weeks. And we also found that the discriminative ability of a change in cervical length was not superior to that of a single measurement at 21 to 23 weeks. Here I show you the discriminative ability of cervical length at 21 to 23 weeks for detection of spontaneous preterm delivery before 33 weeks. These are the results for the 25 millimeter cutoff. The sensitivity was 38.5% and the specificity was 96%. There were 26 false positive test results per each true positive test result, and we needed to screen 629 women to correctly identify one spontaneous delivery before 33 weeks. The size of the high-risk group was 4.4%, that is, 4.4% of the women had cervical length 25 millimeter or less. In our study, the 27 millimeter cervical length cutoff yielded the highest number of correct classifications. The 27 millimeter cervical length cutoff had sensitivity 54% and specificity 92%. There were 35 false positive test results per each true positive test result. And we needed to screen 449 women to correctly identify one spontaneous delivery before 33 weeks. 81% of the women had cervical length 27 millimeter or less. In this table, I have added our results to those of the other five published blinded studies. And as you can see, our results are most similar to those of Davies and colleagues in a study conducted in Canada for detection of preterm delivery before 35 weeks. The measurements were taken at 21 to 24 weeks. Most women in both studies were white. The sensitivity was 25% in both studies, the specificity 97% and 96% respectively, and the size of the high-risk group 3.2% and 4.4% respectively. And the prevalence of spontaneous delivery before 35 weeks was reasonably similar in the two studies, 1.1% and 1.7%. If we look at the positive and negative likelihood ratios associated with the cervical length cutoff 25 millimeter for detection of spontaneous delivery before 35 weeks, we find that cervical length 25 millimeter or less increased the odds of spontaneous delivery before 35 weeks from 4.8 times to 8.3 times. But cervical length 25 millimeter or more decreased the odds of spontaneous delivery before 35 weeks very little. Negative likelihood ratio 0.46 to 0.78. So very moderate discriminative ability. So we can conclude that the shorter the cervix at mid gestation, the higher the risk of spontaneous preterm delivery. The ability to correctly predict spontaneous preterm delivery is better for measurements performed at 21 to 23 weeks than at 18 to 20 weeks. And the discriminative ability of cervical length at 21 to 23 weeks is better the earlier the preterm delivery occurs. And the ability of cervical length at mid-gestation, as measured with ultrasound, to discriminate between women who do and do not deliver spontaneously preterm is at most moderate. But the earlier the spontaneous delivery occurs, the better is the discriminative ability. Now, there is much, much more that I would have liked to tell you about cervical length measurements to predict spontaneous preterm delivery, but there isn't much one can tell you in 15 minutes. And I am ready to answer any questions you might have. And in the end, I just show you these two tables, showing you the discriminative ability of cervical length at 21 to 23 weeks and at 18 to 20 weeks, expressed as area under the ROC curve. And as you can see here, the area under the ROC curve decreases continuously the later spontaneous preterm delivery occurs. And you can also see that the area under the ROC curve reflecting the discriminative ability is better for measurements taken at 21 to 23 weeks than for measurements taken at 18 to 20 weeks. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lil, for this excellent presentation. Very, very interesting data. And unique in the way of consistently that you and the other people on this team who have arranged it. So thank you so much. So if you have any specific question to Professor Valentin, please make questions in the chat, and we will take it when we come to that session, the discussion session. So I will come back now, and I will do a speech on general considerations on preterm delivery prevention, which is the roadmap that we should use to win the bell on preterm delivery. For some of you might have heard this before, but it's important to repeat this, because if we are going to discuss prevention of preterm delivery, we need to have the basic knowledge before we went in to discuss the prevention possibilities with different strategies. So all of us know that the neonatologists here on the call have been much more successful than us, the obstetricians, have been, and there are more kind of inventions on the in pipeline that can be used to maybe improve preterm delivery on the neonatal side. We need a major research effort on the pregnancy side to better understand the pregnancy issues and on the basic biological level. But first, preterm delivery rates, how are they spread? What is the back bottom line? Is there biological variation between the different parts of the world? There are huge variation. This is from different high-income countries in the world. And you can see that some countries, they have preterm delivery rates around 5%. It's in Croatia, Latvia, Finland. And you have a high in Europe, you have as high in Germany as 9%, and in Cyprus around 15%. So there is a huge variation. There was the Integros project, they focused on low risk population, And they found out that there are kind of low risk population for singletons around 4.5%. So there is a possibility to even reduce in high income countries. But why is it so big difference between Sweden and Norway? For instance, they have 6%, and Germany, quite similar organized country, they have 9%, and Cyprus have 15%. I think that we can all agree that these differences are more not likely to biology. There are other things playing around here. And we take this example from between Sweden and Germany. If you adjust for different kind of risk factors, you can reduce the preterm delivery rate, corrected preterm delivery rates in Germany to 8.4%, and in Sweden 5.9%. There is a 2.5% difference between the countries. I will not give you any response, but to exactly what the difference are, it's not easy to do radiation-based studies in Germany, but it's very hard to understand that there are biological reasons that there are a difference between Sweden and Germany of 2.5%. So let's have some reflection on the phenotype. It's important. Professor Valentin has been speaking about spontaneous preterm delivery. This section, about 50% of all preterm deliveries are either induced by preterm labor or preterm pre-labor rupture of membranes. Then you have the complicated pregnancy, like iatrogenic preterm delivery, that is due to intrauterine growth restriction or preeclampsia or other things. And also you have the multiple pregnancy and malformations, and intrauterine fetal death, about 10%, and 10% of all preterm born babies are really multiple pregnancies. So there is quite a mix. And therefore, it's very important to remember this, that if you put it like this, there are really different conditions. And if the membrane rupture or the contraction start, it's just a sign of something else. And then you have all the preeclampsia cases, and there are also uterine malformations that creates preterm delivery, or uterine adhesions after previous kind of intrauterine treatments or procedures. It is not exactly, but it gives an idea thinking about death below 70 years of age, and you have heart disease, cancer, traffic accidents. So it is quite many reasons and are quite different. So it's not one condition, it's many conditions. So it's really a syndrome of syndromes. And one of the syndromes is preterm labor. And we have worked for many years to try to find out the genetics of preterm labor, but it had been very difficult for even a condition like that. But our final breakthrough was when we go to doing a continuous phenotype, instead of subdividing in between delivery before and after 34 weeks or 37 or 28 weeks. The thing was when we used the statistical strength of using a continuous phenotype to have a better understanding. And that was the time when we made a breakthrough. We needed 50,000 women to find a group of genes that were connected to preterm, spontaneous preterm delivery or gestational duration. But if you compare the gestational duration and preterm delivery, you see some of the major hits are represented in both groups. And that is one way to study this, to use to modulate the different phenotypes and find ways forward how to work with it. I want to show you some calculation from the color knowledge, but we have some suggestion treatment for prevention of preterm delivery, progesterone, cervical cyclase, and cervical pessary, and all have something around 0.6 odds ratio to reduce, or 30-40% reduction of the preterm delivery rate. But you need to take into consideration how much would that, I think that one of the most common misunderstanding is that if you have a possible treatment that have a 30-40% reduction, then you will reduce the preterm delivery rate by 30-40%. But that is not true. That is, you need to calculate that by the effect of the treatment and the fraction of the overall phenotype related to that specific indication for the treatment that you give to women. And then you will have a reduction of the overall phenotype. And I will give you some examples of that. And if you, this is American figures compared to Swedish figures. And if you look at this, the US preterm delivery rate at this stage was 12% and in Sweden 6%. And if you see the population, the repeatable fraction, how much you can reduce the preterm delivery rate, focusing on non-indicated cesarean delivery and labor induction might have high income impact in the US, but in Sweden it doesn't have that. And if you look at IRT, assisted reproductive technologies, you can see that as well. And you can see that smoking cessation have low impact on the overall preterm delivery rate, and using cyclage have some impacts, but not huge in comparison to 0.6 for reduction of non-indicated kind of medical interventions, and also for progesterone might have small reduction there. And if you should do as if you should have a kind of cost-effective cervical length screening program using the knowledge that we have. So let's say that the prevalence of short cervix 0.8, less than 20 millimeters is 0.85, and you have a relative reduction of delivery less than 35 weeks of 0.6. This is estimate. So you need in the US to screen 2.2 million scans at least. Many needs to have a second scan or follow-up scans, but that will be a huge effect. And then you will find maybe 11,000 women needed a treatment, and but you will prevent or push from below 35 weeks to above 35 weeks. It will be 900 cases. And that will be in this calculation, a reduction from 9.58 to 9.55%. So it's a very small kind of effect, and it's no low-hanging fruit. Which strategy should we then use? I will give you an example of a possible way of thinking this. One complex phenotype is traffic fatalities. And here is an example from Sweden. It's from 1950s up to 2010. And we have an increased kind of increase in huge increase in traffic volume, but we will at the same time have decreased in the number of deaths. And how did we achieve that? We achieved that by have multiple interventions of seat belts, alcohol, and speed limits, and destruction. So it needs to be many ways to address a complex phenotype like traffic accident, like preterm delivery, many different ways to work with this. So what should be done with the current knowledge? What is the low-hanging fruit? Which fruit can we pick already now without any medical intervention? One thing, and here is from the same Lancet publication, that we can focus on assisted reproductive technologies, and we can also focus on non-medical intervention that is not needed. So here's an example from IRT, that the result of an IRT should be one healthy baby and not multiple pregnancy. And that can be a result of the both ovarian stimulation and multiple embryo transfer. And some states in the US, the doctors are not reimbursed for ART if they create the kind of multiple pregnancy. That is have been one way to handle this. And the other thing is a non-indicated preterm delivery inductions or cesarean sections. Many patients want actions. We know this. Doctor, please deliver me. And also some doctors saying that I will deliver you and doctor. So the indication and be strict with this, because it had been seen that the kind of develop, there had been a left shift of the gestational duration. And there are nice publication from Australia that if you shift it in the post-term deliveries, it will have effect, and you push the curve to the left, not only at week 42 and 41, it will also happen in 39 and 38. So that is important to be aware of that. And I will also give you the importance of research in relation to this. We performed a study within the FIGO working group of preterm delivery a couple of years ago. It was a quite difficult setup, and I will not go through the details there with you, but ending up comparing what is the population attributable fraction of different risk groups that we have. And in single terms, in Sweden, it was 5%. And here you have all the clinical practice changes, low impact on the overall preterm delivery rate. But for the individual cases, it's very important. And then you have the policy and public health issues. One of the things I want to point out for you is that even in a country like Sweden, where women have high education, there are 0.4% reduction if we can increase that from this calculation. But the biggest effect would be nulliparous women, because they are many, they have a tiny fraction, and we don't really understand this. But there is, but since it's many, we would have a treatment that would be the most effective treatment we have. So we really need to have more research. That is the most important thing that we do. We need to focus on public health issues, and we should, of course, develop the clinical practice. So it's important to understand this, and not only saying that we can solve the preterm delivery rates with one of the interventions we have, that will have a small effect on the total delivery rate. So we need, Europe have a unique position, and Professor Moody in the next talk will go into this. We need to register what we are doing. It will be very difficult to do RCTs here. We need to have mandatory register. We need to do continuous validation of data and intervention that will generate data. There are new epidemiological techniques that we can use for this. And we also need to really coordinate both the public hospitals and the private hospitals. We need to have compulsory reporting on what we are doing in Europe. And we have, this is what maybe one of the biggest strengths and possibilities. It's not easy, and it's not easily done in Europe, but we need to, this is maybe easier here than in many other parts of the world. So we should focus on that. We should issue professional organization guidelines. But we need to take brave decisions here also. But it will not be the only one. Our responsibilities as clinical doctors, we can't stop by using the professional organization guidelines. We need to engage in the whole society. And we need to kind of register and validate what we are doing. So I'm sorry, something happens here. I will come back to. So we need to engage in society building. We need to have engage in welfare, health system, and government and healthcare authorities, education, and high household finance, because that will have maybe the most impact reducing the preterm delivery rate. We need to take care of the pregnant women in a way that she turns up at the visits. It may be free pregnancy treatment for all. We need to engage in public health, healthy life, and good life for pregnant women. And we also need to engage what we are mainly doing, medical diagnostics. We need to drive that. We need to develop the treatment and things like that. But we can't stay at that state. We need to engage in other part. And maybe especially put the emphasis on women, reproductive rights, and free healthcare for pregnant women. And we need to work together. We need to work with government, industry, funding organization, the professional organization, and also the patients' organizations. So thank you very much for this. Yes. So the next speaker, I am honored to introduce Professor Neena Moody, professor at neonatal medicine at Imperial College London. She has served in many prestigious positions. One of the most recent is that she has been the head of Royal College of Pediatrics and Child Health. And she has the view on how we can use the real world big data to improve preterm care, both on the obstetrical and the neonatal side. You're most welcome, Neena. The floor is yours. Yeah.
Thank you both. Can you hear me all right?
Am I connected? Yeah.
Thank you very much. Let me start off by saying that Professor Jacobsson and I had not really planned that we would do a double act, but I must say I'm delighted to be following him because many of his comments, and particularly his latter comments about research and the power of big data, I absolutely agree with. And indeed, what I'd like to do is put a little bit more flesh on the bones of those ideas. So what I'm going to talk to you about is not a typical clinical talk. And I think it's fair to say that I would like to dedicate this to all of the young people out there in the audience, because this is your future. This is something that you are going to be able to seize and use the power of big data to improve patient care in a way that we have not hitherto been able to do, largely because the technologies were not there. But these technologies are coming fast and furious, and they most certainly should be seized in order to benefit our patient populations. So in brief, I'm going to talk to you about the patient benefit pathway and the role that real world data can play, then the power of collaboration, and finally finish with some new opportunities that lie before us. So first of all, let me say that one of the goals of my research group has been for a number of years now to harness the power of real world clinical data to improve our clinical practice. And I'm a neonatologist, so include our clinical practice through a number of different routes, whether this is clinical research or health services research or policy research, whether it's any one of the other things that we do to improve patient care. And I'm going to come back to this point in just a moment. And if you're interested in knowing more about what we do, then I have put our website here. Please do have a look at it. A lot of the detail of what I'm going to talk to you about today, you will find on our website. The background, of course, to all of this, as previous speakers have intimated, is that the pace of improvement in patient care is much, much too slow. We all know that randomized controlled trials are a gold standard because you can really elicit reliable causal inferences when you randomly assign treatments. So we know this, and we all strive to practice evidence-based medicine, which is built upon the findings from randomized controlled trials. But we also know that randomized controlled trials are slow, they're expensive, they're usually carried out one at a time, they are underpowered, they have limited external validity, in other words, they have limited generalizability to the entire eligible population. They very often have low representation of underserved communities, and very often, even for comparative effectiveness evaluations, where we are comparing treatments that are already in routine use, randomized controlled trials raise anxiety in patients. And of course, as we all know, they can be very, very burdensome to clinical teams because of the extra work that is entailed. To give you some inkling of the objective evidence that underpins that last statement, let me start by saying that the median cost today, well, in fact, this wasn't today, this came through a paper a few years ago, which said that the median cost of public sector multicenter randomized controlled trials in Europe was roughly about £2 million. Some other important considerations are to really emphasize the fact that large trials are needed to identify reliable treatment effects. And Professor Jacobsson referred to the fact that large studies can be done, but they are very difficult. And by way of practical example, let me say to you that a trial aiming to detect a 25% reduction, that's from 4% to 3% in retinopathy of prematurity, which as you all know is the leading cause of blindness in children, will require at least 14,000 participants. The current Cochrane neonatal library neonatal trials, this is trial included in Cochrane library meta-analyses, contain a median of 80 participants. And this brings another big problem, because small trials increase the risk of false negative effects. In other words, that we will fail to find a result when there is really a result to be found. The other problem is that if we pool many small trials in meta-analyses, this increases the chance that we will falsely find a positive result. And that risk of false positives is increased when we do repeated meta-analyses, adding in more and more and more small trials. This leads us to the conclusion that we also all recognize, which is that 2/3 of current Cochrane neonatal reviews are inconclusive. They do not advance present day practice, either because no randomized controlled trial exists, or the ones that have been done are too small or of too poor quality. So we have a problem. But, and I'm going to use a COVID example here, because of course COVID is very much with us and is the story of this year. There is a but here, and this is a positive message. So the multi-arm adaptive COVID-19 recovery trial, it was testing multiple treatments for COVID positive patients, azithromycin, dexamethasone, hydroxychloroquine. It was an adaptive trial and it was multi-arm, managed to recruit over 13,000 patients in 7 months across 176 sites. But remarkable though this achievement was, it represented only 15% of eligible patients. And had recovery recruited 50%, not even 100%, but 50% of eligible patients, it's estimated that more than 2,000 extra lives would have been saved in the first few months of the trial alone. So lack of efficient research costs lives, and efficient research saves lives. And I think collectively as a community, we have a responsibility to find quicker, easier, cheaper ways to conduct trials with parent support and with the support of clinical teams. Without this, the safety of patients will remain endangered, and we will continue to have persisting uncertainties and variations in care that do not serve our patients well. So our aim has been to make all components of the patient benefit pathway easier, quicker, cheaper by using routine data, because the need to collect data is one of the major barriers to conducting efficient research. And what do I mean by the patient benefit pathway? Well, this is illustrated here. There are many different ways to improve patient care. We can benchmark our outcomes, we can audit our practices, we can quantify variations, we can do observational studies, epidemiological studies, we can do randomized controlled trials, health services research, policy research, we can monitor the safety of new medications and new practices, and we can do quality improvement studies. So these are just many of the components of the patient benefit pathway, which we as clinicians can contribute to, for which we need routine, can use routine data. By using routine data, it avoids having to record these data repetitively for each of these kinds of initiatives. So our principles have been: record clinical data once, do it well, quality assure these data, and hold them securely for national benefit, and then use them for multiple purposes. This reduces the burden of data capture. It reduces the likelihood of inconsistencies and mistakes through repeated data recording. It reduces costs and it speeds the pace of improvements. Now, I know this can be done because we have done this for neonatal medicine in the UK. So I'm going to spend just a few moments talking about the National Neonatal Research Database. This was established way back in 2007. So it has a 14-year track record now of supporting research. And very briefly, let me tell you that there are currently 181 neonatal units in England, Wales and Scotland, and each and every one of these neonatal units contributes to the National Neonatal Research Database. Every single sick baby or preterm baby, every baby who needs over and above normal care will be admitted to one of these 181 NHS neonatal units. So all of these neonatal units use an electronic patient record system, and we construct the National Neonatal Research Database by extracting a standard data set out of the electronic patient record system, a very rich data set that consists of about 450 data variables, many of them recorded daily throughout the baby's inpatient stay. These are held securely. We hold them with the consents of the individual neonatal units. We have the appropriate regulatory approvals. These data are quality assured, and we use these for multiple outputs which span all of the various aspects that I mentioned to you previously. But moving forward, we now have, now that we know how to do this for neonatal medicine in one country, we want to extend this, and many of us around the world contribute in various different ways to international collaboratives. Many of us contribute, for example, to the iNeo network, which is based at the University of Toronto. Many of you will contribute to the Vermont Oxford network. And there is no reason why, given modern technologies for data sharing securely, we cannot contribute to multiple international initiatives. I show here a picture of my friend and colleague, Professor Dominique Aumont, who is a Belgian neonatologist and who established the e-newborn benchmarking platform for European neonatal units. I joined with her as a collaborator some few years ago, and Dominique has now retired from clinical practice, and we have decided after an extensive search that e-newborn will be moving to Imperial College London, where I'm based, to be managed side by side with the National Neonatal Research Database. We are also extending the remit of eNewborn to create an international neonatal research database. And the schema for what we are planning and what we are currently undertaking is shown here, so that UK neonatal units will continue to contribute to the National Neonatal Research Database and will continue to support UK-based outputs. But we will also contribute to the eNewborn International Research Neonatal Research Database, and will invite neonatal units from around the world to do so as well. We have formed an international steering committee who will have governance of the new e-newborn international neonatal research database, and we will use this in a very safe and well-regulated way to support multiple outputs. We need to collaborate because we need big numbers, and we need to collaborate because none of us has got the time to do things repetitively. I would like to end by saying that eNewborn is open to all neonatal units internationally to participate. There is a very flexible data submission system. We will continue to do benchmarking as previously, and there will be no charges for neonatal units that collaborate. We will not use any data for any research study without the explicit permission of each neonatal unit or contributing network, and we will resource eNewborn through cost recovery from research that is supported. So to end, we need big numbers and we need collaboration internationally in order to do efficient research. We need to bring together clinical teams, regulators, parents and patients, funders and researchers. And together we can speed the pace of improvements in newborn care. I want to end by saying thank you to the steering board of the National Neonatal Research Database and my chairs, Professor Andrew Wilkinson and Kate Costello, and lots and lots of collaborators who you see here, and also to my research team, who are very diverse indeed. Data scientists, statisticians, admin staff, parent public involvement leads, and our PhD students and researchers. Thank you very much, EAP, for inviting me to take part in this this webinar.
Yeah, thank you so much, Neena. It really ended up exactly as I wanted, because it's the idea of what we can do in Europe that is different from many other parts of the world, and you show how these can work together. Now I want to introduce also Professor Andy Shennan from King's College in London, and also Harald Ehrhardt from Gießen in Germany. Andy Shennan is an obstetrician, as you know, and Harald Ehrhardt is neonatologist from Gießen in Germany. Is there any question from the panel here that you want to give to somebody else? We have received a couple of questions here that we are going to take, but if some of the panel members want to ask somebody else on the panel, we can start with that. Andy?
So I got a question for Lil, if that's all right. Really, really enjoyed your talk, Lil. Thank you. The message I take home is from low-risk screening is that sensitivity is relatively mild. I only really have experience in high-risk screening of the cervical length. And what we find is the sensitivity is also not that strong in a high-risk group. So we tend to add in a biomarker, for example, fibronectin, which really discriminates well in the short cervix, and we use that to dictate our management. It's interesting because NICE currently say don't use these together, although they're referring to symptomatic patients. But I wondered whether you had a view about improving on the sensitivity and how that might translate into management decisions.
I think maybe we regret that we didn't examine the value of fibronectin. I can't say what it would add because I have no evidence and no data, but we would have liked to test it in our study. I'm not aware actually of studies using both. I know there are studies, but I don't think there are any blinded studies. There is a study from United States where they used both fibronectin and cervical length measurements in oliparous women, but it was not a blinded study. I'm sorry that I cannot answer your question, but it's interesting.
But you have some data on this, Andy, in the KIP app.
Yes, I mean, as Lil says, blinded studies are important. The trouble with high-risk women is almost impossible to do those studies. But in large numbers of high-risk women, we know that combining them works well. And even when we control for the interventions, it works well. So we like to use them together in asymptomatic women. And the big question, of course, is does it help direct intervention? And I still think those studies need to be done.
Yes, we have one question from Jordi Kostadinov asking us about, should pregnant women with a history of conization be screened by cervical length as others, or should they be treated differently? Cyclage could be performed in week 16 to 18, according to good clinical practice. Andy will have the word secondly, but I will ask Lil about this first.
Yeah. Well, the only thing I can say is that because we have looked in our study population at different risk groups, and one group was women with a previous conization. And the only thing we can say from the results of our study is that cervical length screening works as well in women who have undergone conization as in women without conization. So the screening performance seems to be the same, but treatment, I don't think there is any evidence how we should best treat these women who have undergone conization with or without cervical length screening. I don't think there is any randomized trial.
Andy?
Yeah, so I would like to add to that. You know, we actually published a paper in American Journal looking at over 400 women who had primips who'd had conization, and the fibronectin and the cervical length are very, very good predictors in nullips with conizations, even better predictors with rock areas than prior preterm birth. So actually, they're an incredibly good test to tell us who's at risk. And as Lil says, I completely agree. We don't have the trials to show that intervention works in this group, but logically it would, being given that this is a physical assault on the cervix. Whenever I've tried to get funding to look at trials in this area, all the oncologists tell me vaccines will stop this problem. There's no point funding this. They've been saying that for 20 years, but they're still very common in our clinic. So we pragmatically do intervene in these women if they're very high risk.
So what's the best intervention? Is it cerclage or something else?
Well, we like cerclage simply because this is a physical problem, physical defect, and therefore a physical solution seems logical. But, you know, we have very little evidence to support that. But I think logically a physical solution works well. I like using cerclage. We're doing trials comparing it with progesterone, but it's a logical step in this group.
Yeah. Any other comments here from Miroslav or somebody else?
Maybe I can add something to the, it was a fantastic session from early screening to the big world data. And I really enjoyed the talk of Neena Modi, but is it enough just to have these big data available, or do we need a combined approach of biomarkers plus these data sets to really approach this unsolved questions?
Shall I take that, Bo?
Yeah, certainly, yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Harald. That's a very good question. And again, you know, I could have expanded on this because you're absolutely right. Of course, once one has a big clinical data set, then of course it becomes possible to link this to biobanks. For example, it also becomes possible to link to other sorts of data. And we have a very large program of research, which is trying to do just this. But it's a slow business, but it can be done. And it's getting easier as each year goes by because the technologies are getting better and better and better. So we did an MRC pilot study involving a large number of very preterm families, captured DNA samples from them. So this was trios, mum, dad, and baby, extracted DNA, answered a research question with it, lodged the DNA in a biobank and asked the parents, this was an important part of the study. We asked the parents, would you be happy for these DNA samples to be stored in a biobank and used for other approved research purposes? And would you be happy for clinical data about outcomes on your babies to be retrieved from the National Neonatal Research Database and other routine databases through linkage? And for both of those questions, over 90% of parents said yes, they would be happy to do this for regulatory approved studies. So I think our families really want us to use data well and use it efficiently. But we need to involve them in developing these modalities, but it can be done. I think the days of trying to do everything together are gone. I might have a clinical database, you might have a biobank. What we need to do is link these two together so that we're joining forces collaboratively.
Yeah, this is really great what you said, and it's important to have the patients and the families on board because we have so different regular restrictions across Europe. We have to harmonize and to get this together. As Bo said, we have to set up efforts also to find the reasons for these discrepancies between the different countries.
So there is another question from Malik Al-Kasim regarding if it's better to detect cervical length in week 21 to 23 weeks. Is that too late? Is the intervention possibilities for cerclage gone? Should we screen at week 21 to 23 instead? Any comments on that?
Can I answer? Yeah. Or no, Andy? But I I think we have shown that screening at 21 to 23 weeks works so much better than screening earlier. And if progesterone is the prophylaxis that we would like to give, it's not too late. because all randomized trials, I think, have started progesterone treatment around 20 to 24 weeks and not any earlier. For cerclage, I don't know. We hardly use cerclage in Sweden, but maybe Andrew Shennan wants to say something about that.
Andy?
Yes, I'm quite happy to give cerclage up to 24 weeks. And the actual practicalities of this in high-risk women is we will screen early because you want to treat early if you can. But if they're normal early, then you do a repeat test before 24 weeks where you get the best prediction. You still have opportunities to intervene. So we will offer, you know, cerclage or progesterone often in a trial in that circumstance. So I think it's good to do an early check to just check you're not missing the opportunity to treat early. But if they're normal, you need to treat. Check again closer to where you say 21 to 23 weeks before you rule out the possibility of intervening. So we tend to do two checks, 18 and 23 weeks.
The situation is very different, of course, if you deal with a high-risk population. Our study was to assess screening in a total population. So the situation is different. I really understand your way of looking at it.
So another question here is then, should we do cervical length screening for the whole population then? Is one of the questions coming up here. Should we have universal screening? Is that cost effective?
There are some cost effectiveness studies, and we are now using our data to check if it would be cost effective in Sweden. Whether it's cost effective or not, it must depend, I think, on the demographics and how common is spontaneous preterm delivery. So we are looking at it from a Swedish perspective now.
And we will be back reporting that at a later occasion, I think.
Andrew?
Yeah. So I don't want to take the show constantly, but I can report to you that in the last week we've had discussions with the screening committee in the UK, and they've made the decision not to do low risk screening based on the sort of dynamics of cost and impact. So as yet, widespread low risk screening is not advocated in the UK, and I think that's going to be for some years now.
But in UK also there is quite little use of vaginal ultrasound in pregnant women among general practitioner or general obstetrician people.
But I think in high-risk patients, Bo, and obviously your definition of high risk is very flexible. Because you can go, you know, large numbers of people have had LETSs and other risk factors. So we do increasingly screen people, which I think is correct. But the question is the cost effectiveness and what risk status justifies routine screening. And I think the low risk NULLIP, for example, is not included now as in most people's criteria for need to screen.
Yes.
But the other question, I think, is if we can replace transvaginal cervical length measurement by transabdominal measurement in low-risk population. What is your opinion?
Yeah, so I think that there are the available data is not very substantial on that. And a lot of, often it's said that short cervix is one thing and normal and long cervix is a different thing. But I think that the sensitivity will of course decrease much more than if you are close to the cervix and it's possible to really do a good measure. And the sensitivity and specificity will certainly decrease. And if it's not at best moderate, it will be. I'm skeptical about that. So I think that if it turns out in cost effectiveness to be effective, I think that the next stage is also to develop a kind of biomarker and see if we can increase it by that. And then we need to repeat some of the prevention studies to see how effective the treatment is. Maybe it's better than 0.6 or 7 or so. Andy or Lil, can you?
Cervical length measurement by transabdominal ultrasound. I have heard colleagues say, but can't we just check if it's very long? We need not worry. If it seems to be very long, we need not worry. If it seems not to be very long, we can check vaginally. But I really don't think that you can assess cervical length very well abdominally at 18 or 20 weeks.
Lily, Andy, did you have more comments on that?
No, I agree. I mean, I think you sacrifice accuracy and I guess you gain acceptability, and there's somewhere there must be a joining of those two things. I think we need to know that widespread screening is valuable before we introduce any screening. So I think I think it's a very, very good point, but the debate is still raging.
Let's see if we can, Neena's, Dr. Professor Moody and my talk were more of theoretical and long-term outcomes. There will be less practical questions there. Neena, do you want to fill in?
I have a question, if I may, for my obstetric colleagues, because prediction is an important issue, but a very brief summary on whether you feel that the actions that are to be taken following prediction are sufficiently well researched, coordinated, and integrated. I'd be very interested in your views on that. We, of course, see it from the neonatal perspective, but it would be good to get your views from your perspectives.
Andy?
Yeah, Neena, that's such an excellent question. I mean, I think the reason why the national screening body has not jumped on that, on widespread screening, is exactly that. The evidence base around interventions in low-risk women is very scarce. And although the kind of meta-analysis on progesterone is looking promising on all groups, there isn't larger numbers of low-risk women in that meta-analysis. So we're still struggling a bit about widespread interventions in relatively low-risk women. And as Bo has shown us, you know, huge numbers come from this nulliparous low-risk population in terms of the actual workload that you guys receive in neonatology. So it's a real tough nut to crack. And I still think we're struggling with the interventions in that group. So excellent question, and I haven't got a good answer for you. But you're right, prediction is now getting really good. The next challenge is to link those predictions to the interventions, and that's what we're struggling with in our trials at the moment.
Some more questions. I see there is many practical questions here regarding different kind of intervention and things like that. I would suggest you go to the FIGO website and follow, because there will be a FIGO webinar on the World Prematurity Day of 17th of November, and addressing many of these issues that you have regarding pessary, cyclage, and so on. Harald, do you have more questions from the neonatal side here?
At the moment, not.
Yeah. So I believe, Neena, that one of the important issues is here to spread this exactly. I of course I know what you would say in this issue if I ask you to talk on this issue, and that was also the idea that we in Europe have unique possibility to gather this data across countries, and that we need to do it however our politicians take us out and in different kind of collaboration. But do you have any collaboration outside, or how much collaboration outside the UK you have in your setup?
Yes. So I mentioned this. I mentioned this briefly. That we collaborate with a multi-country collaboration, which is led by Prakasha and Shu Lee from the University of Toronto. There are about 14 countries involved in this who share neonatal data and have used it for, you know, there are multiple publications that have come out of this now, and some very, very interesting between country comparisons. So we absolutely collaborate with countries within Europe. This 12 country collaboration that I mentioned has got countries within Europe, but also countries outside of Europe as well. So I think, again, the days of saying that, you know, this is my data and I can only collaborate with you and not with you, these are gone. I think we can all collaborate in very, very many different ways, and we can cut our cloth as is necessary according to the research question. Also, the technology is becoming possible now so that we don't actually physically have to send data anywhere, because one can use a safe haven, one can use remote technologies to actually access the data in a secure way. And so again, the old fashioned way of saying, well, I have to send you data, those are gone too. So the opportunities for Europe, I think, are considerable, because although we have different regulatory frameworks in each of the European countries, they're nonetheless more harmonized. And I will say this, even as a Brit, and by the way, I did not vote for Brexit, but I will say that across Europe, we still have processes that can be brought together very, very effectively indeed. And certainly with e-newborn, we know that it's possible to share neonatal data across Europe.
Ask Neena, because the idea of getting data from the whole of Europe is really exciting, not only for neonatology, I would say for obstetrics also. Can I just ask, what do you, in your experience, are the main difficulties in getting this database together, across the different European countries? And the second is, you know, how have you tackled the issue of the quality of data? Because now, when you're dealing with big databases, sometimes quality is an issue.
Thank you very much, Diogo. Again, very spot on questions. We could have a week long seminar about all of this, but I'll try and be very brief. So the quality issue is really important, and that really depends upon us, the clinicians, because the approach that we've taken is that we don't want to give clinicians any more work, so the data will come out of an electronic patient record system. But it does mean that we have to have detailed quality assurance processes in place, which we do. So again, I can talk to you separately about this, but we have multiple tiers of quality assurance, because it's absolutely crucial that it's crucial both from a patient care perspective, but also for research. We need data that is of a research standard, and research standard data is good for patient care as well, because it's high quality data. So we've got several tiers of quality assurance. The second issue, of course, is the regulatory requirements. And I think each country, my view is that each country has to tackle this separately, because countries differ so considerably. But if there is one champion within a country who can tackle the regulatory requirements for their country, then we can join forces across countries. So that's the second key issue. And the third issue is the technology. And I've already briefly said that there are many, many ways of dealing with the technical issues now. So for me, those are the three components: the regulatory issues, which have to be solved in country; the technical considerations, which can be resolved across country; and then there is the very, very clinician-focused issues. If we're talking about using real-world data from EPR systems, we have to take our clinical colleagues with us on this journey. They have to be committed, and they have to see the value of what emerges from it. And that's why I emphasize the fact that we can use these data for many, many different purposes, all of which are important to clinical care, whether it's audit or surveillance, a quality improvement, or research down at the other end. So in a nutshell.
Thanks. Yeah.
So Harald, one final question.
Yeah, maybe also it's very difficult this time now with the COVID pandemic. We might also learn something else. Some people reported differences in preterm birth rates, for example, in Ireland or in Israel. So maybe we could learn from changes in behavior and from these restrictions as well, how this impacts preterm birth rates. And this would be a question to Neena Modi. Did you see any changes in your registry so far?
So I can't give you the answer to that, but I can tell you that we're busy analyzing at the moment, and it's all looking very interesting indeed, but the analysis is not complete. So we've got 14 years worth of data for the UK. We will have some interesting findings about how COVID has impacted neonatal services and neonatal outcomes. But I can't tell you more than that at the moment, Harold, because that analysis is underway at the moment.
So The background for Harald's question is that there have been several reports showing that the decrease of preterm delivery during the COVID era here had been substantial, but there is not totally consistent. But I think that we will come back to that in our webinar next autumn. Thank you so much for that question. So now we have an abstract that was submitted to us from Gloria González Tristante, who is a resident in obstetrics and gynecology at University Hospital 12 de Octubre in Madrid, Spain. So you are welcome to do your presentation now, 7 minutes and a couple of questions after. And I would also say that this is perinatal medicine abstract better than this. It's really on the spot between obstetrics and neonatology.
Hi, everybody. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi, welcome, everybody. My name is Gloria González. I am a second-year resident of gynecology at Hospital 12 de Octubre in Madrid. And I'm going to talk about the perinatal management and neonatal outcomes at the limit of viability. The limit of viability is not a static concept and has changed over the last decade, and nor it is the same all around the world. For example, in Japan, the limit is 22 weeks due to its proactive management with periviable newborns. Further, the survival of extremely preterm infants has increased during the last years, although ethical, medico-legal, and economic aspects have to be considered. The management of periviable deliveries is a major challenge in developed countries. There is a general agreement between European and American clinical guidelines that at 22 weeks, there is no hope of survival and comfort care will be provided until death. For week 25 onwards, an active management that includes antenatal corticosteroids, magnesium sulfate, cesarean section for fetal indication, and admission to a neonatal intensive care unit should be offered. The great uncertainty are deliveries between 23 to 24 plus 6 weeks. The aim of this study is to analyze perinatal management and neonatal outcomes at this gray zone. A cross-sectional study was developed among 53 pregnant women admitted at my hospital, whose delivery was between 23 to 24 plus 6 weeks of gestation. A total of 53 women and 60 fetuses were included. We exclude pregnancies with antepartum fetal death or major disease. We analyze different variables potentially affect clinical outcomes such as prenatal weight, sex, use of antenatal corticosteroids, gestational age, or plurality. We attend every year about 4,000 deliveries, and the incidence of perinatal ones in our area is stable, about 0.2-0.3% per year. Most pregnant women were 30 years old, not fatty, Caucasians, and nulliparous. As you can see in the slide, we also analyze maternal factors related to premature birth. Periviable gestation were mostly spontaneous and singleton ones. Only 15% were twin pregnancy. I show you here obstetric pathology related to premature birth in our sample. 61% of cervical weakness was managed with a cerclage or a pessary. The main reason for admission was uterine dynamics, followed by premature rupture of the membranes, cervical weakness, or infection. Median of admission was too short, between 2 or 4 days. That means that many times we didn't have time to take a quickly decision before birth. Comfort care in this study was offered before birth in 26%, all below 23 plus 6 weeks. Active care was offered before birth in 74%. All pregnancies of 24 weeks onward received active management. In this graphic, you can see in blue a weak tendency to start earlier antenatal corticosteroids. In general, those who didn't receive active management were male fetuses with a lower gestational age and a lower weight. No cesarean section was made in this group. We made cesarean section only if active management was decided and always was made for 24 weeks onwards. The main reason was fetal malpresentation and classical incision was made in 30%. After an active obstetric management, infants were admitted to a neonatal intensive care unit where they received different active care according to its extremely preterm condition. Global mortality in our study was between 32 to 36% the first year, 50% at week 23. We also analyzed moderate to severe morbidity, such as intraventricular hemorrhage, necrotizing enterocolitis, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and retinopathy of premature. This major morbidity was between 53 to 59% the first year. Finally, we summarize management at 23 versus 24 weeks of gestation. All patients at 24 weeks received active management versus only a few patients of 23 weeks. Below 23 plus 6 weeks, no one delivered by cesarean section, 50% died, and 50% who survived had major morbidity. At 24 weeks, 63% delivered by cesarean section, 30% died, and 60% survived with major morbidity. Our data are similar to another studies. But what is really important is that perinatal management is difficult due to the lack of a high quality evidence in the literature. Decisions have to be taken by a multidisciplinary team with neonatologists, obstetricians, psychologists, considering parents' wishes. We have to individualize cases and we have to know modifiable factors that potentially affect clinical outcomes. And that's all. Thank you so much.
So thank you very much, Gloria. It was a nice presentation. Any questions for Gloria? Is this data from Spain comparable to Germany? Harald?
Yes, in principle, yes, and also to the European registries. What would be interesting for me is, did you analyze babies born by cesarean section versus spontaneous delivery? Did you see any differences, i.e. in mortality or combined morbidity?
No, we didn't find any differences between the mode of delivery.
Because this is still an unsolved question to the outcome.
Our sample is shorter. We need to introduce birth of this year and following years to find something interesting.
Yeah. And did you compare antenatal steroids versus no antenatal steroids? And did you look at the reasons why certain women did not receive antenatal steroids?
Sorry?
Did you also compare if the baby received antenatal steroids, yes or no?
Yes.
And did you check for the reasons why certain mothers did not receive antenatal steroids?
those who receive comfort care have adverse factors to, for example, time of a premature rupture of the membranes, major disease, anomalies, congenital anomalies, another reason, another factors I've got here. For there are also some fetuses that were intrauterine growth restriction, and male sex is also an adverse factor. It has to be part in all factors when we tell we are with your parents, when they have to do a pre-delivery plan. They have to be informed with all these factors.
Neena, please.
Thank you very much, Gloria. Thank you for a nice, clear presentation. I have a question about whether or not there is a lot of discussion in Spain about this issue, or whether everyone is very, very happy with the guideline and there is no debate about this now.
In Spain, we don't have any special clinical guideline about perivariable deliveries. We haven't got any special clinical guideline. In here in my hospital, in 12 de Octubre Hospital, we have just last day written a new protocol about the management of these fetuses. But we are also collecting data of our hospital.
Okay, sounds like there's going to be a lot of discussion.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. One surprising thing was that there was more active management in fetuses or male sex. Do you know anything about the explanation? Was it because they were bigger, or did they know about the sex of the babies? Gloria, do you hear me?
We have read in the literature that male sex is an adverse factor, prognostic factor, to deliver at this gestational age. But I don't know why it's an adverse prognostic factor.
I think that according to the slides, I got the impression that they were most actively handled than the, so it was 60% or 70% that were boys, that were male sex of the actively handled patients.
Yes, but I don't know.
Oh, dear, okay.
It was the other way around, but maybe I misunderstood.
Was it the other way around? It would make more sense, I think. Okay. Thank you so much, everyone. Any final comment? We are 5 minutes over, so it's time to sum up. Any short comment or something like that in the general topics here? Then I want to thank everyone for the participation, Professor Moody and Professor Valentin, and for the contribution with the talks, very good discussion from panel members of the EAPM and Professor Shennan and Hart and it is second names and first names, sorry, Ehrhardt in Germany. And thank you for MCA for the help, and also the biggest thank you for the participants. And if you have more specific questions about the different interventions, please join us for the FIGO prevention discussion during the next Tuesday at 8 p.m. Central European time.
Thank you very much, Bo and Neena, for organizing this. Thank you for the special interest group on prenatal. Thanks very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
That we have still a lot to do.
Yeah, a lot of things to do, certainly, yes.
Okay.
Bye.